हेलो डियर स्टूडेंट्स, दिस वीडियो इज़ मेड फॉर द स्टूडेंट्स ऑफ इंग्लिश लिटरेचर BA पार्ट थर्ड। एंड इन दिस वीडियो वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी अ पोएम डोवर बीच दैट इज़ प्रेस्क्राइब्ड इन योर सिलेबस। डोवर बीच इज़ अ पोएम कंपोज बाय मैथ्यू अर्नोल्ड। एंड एज वी हैव डिस्कस्ड इन आवर प्रीवियस वीडियो ऑफ दिस पोएम डोवर बीच about the writer Matthew Arnold, his notable works, his genre, his era, the era which he belongs, and in this video we will explain, I am going to explain the poem text before, text is placed on your screen, and this poem has the theme of loss of faith and certainty. And this poem was first published in 1867 in the collection of New Poems. The title, locale, and the subject is the shore of the English ferry port of Dover in France. At the Strait of Dover, the narrowest part of the English Channel. So the opening lines of the poem is, "The sea is calm tonight, the tide is full. The moon lies fair upon the straits." Now you can see, students, that the first line is complete in itself and there is no decorative words used in this line. The line is very simple and clear that the poet is mentioning about the natural scene at the coast of England. He is saying that the sea is calm tonight, the tide is full, and the moon lies fair upon the straits. Straits are the narrowest part of that sea. Here we can see that the speaker is on the coast of England, looking out at the English Channel, which separates England from France. Dover is a town right at the narrowest part in the point in the channel. So here you can see in line 2 and 3 the poet has used enjambment, as line number 2 is not ending with any comma or full stop. Rather, it is continuing in the third line. So the poet is saying about mentioning the natural scenery there. He is saying that the sea is calm tonight and the tide is full. The moon lies fair upon the straits. The moonlight is brightly shining on the straits. On the French coast, the light gleams and is gone. Now he is, as you know, that he is right there towards French coast, the coast of England, and at the English Channel, out at the English Channel. So he is saying that before his eyes, the light of the moon has shining on the French coast and is gone. Now he is mentioning about the light that is behind him has gone, and the cliffs of England stand. And he is now mentioning about the rocky part, the cliffs of that English Channel, glimmering and vast out in the tranquil bay. Here he is saying that the moonlight is glimmering and it is covering the vast part of that English Channel and Dover Beach out in the tranquil bay. And the bay is very silent at the time. Now in line number 6, he is saying that, "Come to the window, sweet is the night air." So this line indicates that poet is in a room with a window and there is someone with him whom he is addressing to come to the window and to smell the night air. He is saying that, "Come to the window and sweet is the night air." Only from the long line of spray. Here you can see a pause in the line, and this indicates the use of caesura, that is a pause in line. He He is saying that only from the long line of spray where the sea meets the moon blanched land. Only the word only here refers to but. So now the speaker draws our attention to the edge of water and the surf. Instead of looking at the beautiful landscape as a whole, we are looking at the specific point where the sea meets the land. Now he is saying that where the sea meets the moon blanched land. Moon blanched means the whitened land or the bleached land due to the sun, due to the moon light of the moon. Now he is addressing again, he is using apostrophe sign, and he is saying that listen, you hear the grating roar. Now you can see the change that in stanza, in the above lines of this stanza, the poet is talking about the calmness, the tranquility of that natural scene, but now he is saying that listen, you hear the grating roar. Now what is the sound of this grating, this noisy sound is of what? So in our next line he is completing the sentence like, you hear the grating roar of pebbles which the waves draw back and fling. Now you can imagine that he is talking about the noisy sound of the pebbles that were carried forward with the water waves, and after the ebb the pebbles are drew back. So these are the noisy sound he is talking about. At the return up the high strand. Strand here means beach or shore. Now he is talking about the returning of those pebbles that were earlier carried forward with the waves. They are now with the returning of the waves, they are now drew back. Up the high strand means they are now at their return, they are now placed at the high beach or shore. Begin and cease, and then again begin. This line indicates the perfect example of iambic pentameter. So line number 12, begin and cease, and then again begin. This is a perfect example of iambic pentameter. With the tremulous cadence slow. Now he is continuously talking about the sound of the waves, the returning waves and the coming waves that carry with them the pebbles. And now he is saying that tremulous here means shaky or trembling. Cadence means rhythm of that repeated sound. So here he is saying that with the tremulous cadence slow and bring the eternal note of sadness in. Now he is somewhat philosophical and he is saying that this is not the end of these sound, but these sound, these notes are eternal, and they indicate the melancholy feelings or the sadness always present there, and this will remain forever. So these, in this first stanza, he is starting with the natural scenery of sea and tide and the straits. Rather, he is rolling on towards the sounds of the waves, the activities of the waves. And in the last lines of this stanza, he is choosing a perfect example of iambic pentameter, and he is saying about that these sounds that are created with the to and fro of the waves, these sounds always has the note of sadness in them. Our next stanza start with the name of Greek playwright who wrote many tragic plays, Sophocles. So he is mentioning, he is in the time machine, and he is going towards the past, and he is saying that Sophocles long ago heard it on the Aegean, and it brought into his mind the turbid ebb and flow of human misery. Now, after that you can see there is a caesura in line number 4 of human misery. Here the poet takes a pause, and he is in these above 4 lines he is talking about the past. He is saying that Sophocles has, he is imagining that maybe Sophocles has long ago heard these note of sadness in the waves of Aegean Sea. Aegean Sea is the sea that is a part of Mediterranean Sea, and it is separate Greece from Turkey. So here the poet is mentioning that maybe Sophocles has also long ago heard the same sadness sounds in the waves of Aegean Sea, and it brought into his mind, and these note of sadness has brought into his mind the turbid ebb and flow of human misery. Now here the poet is philosophically changing his mood, and he is comparing this ebb and flow, the tide and ebb of these waves, to the miserable life of human. So here he is saying, turbid here means cloudy. So he is saying that maybe Sophocles has long ago heard the sound of heard the note of sadness in Aegean Sea's waves, and therefore he mentioned the human misery of ebb and flow in his plays. We find also in the sound a thought. Now here he is addressing the readers that we are also hearing these sounds, and we can create a thought there, hearing it by this distant northern sea. Now he is saying that we can hear these sounds. Now he is in the present, and he is mentioning that we can also hear the sound of sadness at present in this distant northern sea. Here the word distant has two meanings. First is the far away sea, that is Aegean Sea and the English Channel, and second distant word here refers to the time span between past and present. So that's all for today. In our next video, I will explain to you the remaining part of this poem. So thank you all.